at 9:05 Pacific Time, 12:05 Eastern Time. Welcome, everybody. I'm Laura Bueller. I'm the Executive Director of C100. Thank you so much for joining us for today's virtual roundtable. I really hope that all of you are dialing in from the safety and security and solitude of your home offices, wherever you are joining us from. The remarkable thing about Zoom is that wherever you are, we have found, of course, there's really shortened distances between people. So welcome. Today is a first for C100 and certainly a first for our team. So thanks so much for being so enthusiastic to join us. We partnered up with Careerlist, who I'll describe in a moment, to kick off this short series that will last for at least a few weeks on your downturn playbook. For those of you who are new to C100, C100 is a member-supported, not-for-profit member association headquartered in San Francisco, California. We have members across major technology hubs of the US, Canada, and beyond. C100's members, of whom there are many here today, both individual and organizational, represent what we feel is a preeminent global community that is committed to supporting, inspiring, and connecting the most promising Canadian entrepreneurial leaders. Our programs aim to support Canadian technology leaders through mentorship, investment, partnership, and talent. Now today, we are joined by Careerlist. Careerlist is a recruiting platform that connects employers with talent through a network of independent recruiters. Michael Scissons is our moderator today, and he is Careerlist's founder and CEO. He is a New York-based C100 member. He's an entrepreneur and an investor, and has seen all sides of every proverbial table. And it was actually on his recommendation that we kicked off this series. So thank you so much for supporting us and creating member-driven content, Mike. I'm really excited about today's conversation.
Thanks, Laura.
For everyone's knowledge, we will be sharing a recording of the core content, however, not of the Q&A later on. And so feel free to be candid with your questions. Put them in the Q&A bubble if any of you are having trouble finding it. I believe it should be at the bottom of your screen if you're on your laptop. And you can put questions in there throughout the discussion. And our moderator, Michael Scissons, and Joshua Goodfield from the C100 team will help to synthesize those questions for the group later on. Once again, the Q&A period will not be recorded, so we want you to feel like you can be really candid.
It's scary. What are we supposed to say now, you know?
And once again, I just want to thank all of C100's members who are here today for supporting everything we do in our service for Canadian entrepreneurs. If C100 membership is, of course, something any of you want to explore down the line, let us know, check out our website, and just welcome to those of you who are visiting. So for now, I will kick it off and hand it over to Mike. Thank you so much again, Mike, and I'll have you introduce our panelists today.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks for everything that you're doing, both in these times and all the time, invaluable to the entire ecosystem, both in Canada and here in the US. Really excited to have two close friends join today. Our good friend, Jen from GGV, who is the head of talent, who is definitely, she won't say this, but I will, one of the, I think, most connected, most insightful, most knowledgeable people, both in what's happening in talent, as well as across a wide collection of portfolio companies and non-portfolio companies around the world. Jen, thank you so much for making time to join us.
Thank you for the kind words, Mike. It's great to be here.
Thanks for coming, and we've got our from Madan, who's seeing this from all sides on the operations side, and is living it now. Madan and I met through the early days of Facebook, and then I believe he was at Amazon, and now he was at Compass, and now he's the chief people officer of Blink Health. So he's lived this in a lot of different size organizations, in a lot of different ways. And what I was hoping we could start off with was maybe with you, Jen, is just a quick explanation in terms of what macro themes that you're seeing happen. And I think today's theme around leading with compassion. What are you seeing happen, and how are people kind of handling this more compassionately than maybe we've seen, previous downturns in the past?
Absolutely. So a couple things. First, just straight away, a lot of our companies are, and just by way of kind of introduction and a little bit of context about GGV, we're for those of you who don't know us or aren't familiar, we're a global venture capital firm. We have offices in San Francisco, in Menlo Park, in Beijing, in Shanghai, in Singapore, and about 250 active portfolio companies, as Michael said, that range from seed companies, so four people, up through Airbnb in terms of size and scope. So we have a broad range in which we invest, and we invest in enterprise companies and consumer companies and drones and robotics and all kinds of things. And what a lot of our companies are facing right now, whether they have enough cash for the foreseeable future or not, they're all kind of looking at that. They're looking at 2020 plans. And they're thinking about employees. I've been so impressed by, to the point of leading with compassion, kind of the employee first mantra has been really pervasive across the portfolio with companies big and small. And CEOs and founders are just really thinking through the way to address. In many cases, companies are doing some layoffs and they're thinking about how to preserve cash in case this is a difficult fundraising environment on a go forward, but they're really thinking about employees first, and happy to get into it today, but that is a macro trend that I'm certainly seeing is compassion. Happy to say that. I've been just blown away by the things that some of the companies and the founders are doing. Happy to share them today, but compassion is certainly one of them, and creativity. I would say people are certain founders are recording videos every morning. Others are doing walking AMAs, and it goes on from there. But thinking about how to preserve cash and do layoffs, do all of that with compassion, and think about employees and then their one degree kind of circles, if you will, be it family, be it friends, anybody who may be vulnerable to the coronavirus, and thinking about the broader ecosystem around the employee base.
And thanks, that's great. Madan, what are you, you're here. Yeah. And a broader context, like clearly did a very bad intro. Jen is in San Francisco. I think Jen justice as well. And you're here in New York, which I think we all have different contexts as well based on where we are.
Yeah, I think Jen really hit it on there. Exactly in terms of the support and the leadership expected from both people leaders and CEOs and execs is just of a very different kind. Leading with empathy on one hand, on the other hand, you're trying to even figure out, do you have enough cash and what's your burn and all the difficult decisions that you're going to be making just to kind of survive whatever this the length of this crisis is going to be. I think what we're also seeing is as an operational HR leader and operational business leadership, what exec teams are doing outside of the emotional support is trying to be focused on being truthful. People want to know exactly what's going on. Questions which were usually reserved for one-on-one conversations get asked in town halls. What's our burn rate? How much money do we have in the bank? We heard about this layoff. Are you thinking about layoff next week, next month? The questions are very raw. And so many leaders are not prepared for that. So there's a lot of support that needs to happen. And then three, on an operating basis, how do you make a virtual workforce where you pretty much 100% of your workforce is now virtual? How do you make them productive? How do you make them innovative? How do you, outside of making Zoom work, which is itself a technical challenge sometimes, how do you kind of create that level of visible work? And so the strategy is just not on saying, okay, we're going to be remote, but in a remote environment, what does work look like? How can you be visible about work? Everything from your company dashboard, which were probably available, when you would meet with people, now have to be turned into some virtual kind of UI. So those are the challenges that you're facing. But for an employee, I think the immediate question is, Do we have enough cash in the bank? Can we get through for the next 3 months, 6 months? And what does it mean for me and my family?
Yeah, maybe, Madan, I'll take a dive there and, you know, share a personal story. I think we were, like so many of my friends and other founders were, we were in a situation where, you know, our company had had 6 quarters of consecutive growth. We had just closed, you know, a small round, not a big round, but enough based on like current business plan and reasonable forecast that you've got 18 to 24 months of, you know, runway. I think what made this, and I'm like, oh, you know, we're recession ready. And in some ways we probably would have been, but you know, this felt and was so much different. And I think it impacted different businesses in different ways. And Jim, we were talking yesterday where e-commerce companies are seeing, you know, uptake, where obviously talent companies are a little slower right now, but that's okay. You know, we can help other people and redeploy, you know, resources. But, you know, I think the CEO of Marriott said it really well in his video, if people haven't watched it, which was, you know, after last major recession, it was tough. And, you know, we saw revenue decline by 25% and it was tough. We got through it. You know, in some ways, this just feels like a stop or a pause. And it's sitting with this, you know, undetermined. If you're a specific elected official here in the US, you think it's over by Easter. If you're pretty much anybody else, you realize it's probably not, you know, going to be over by Easter. And that we're, you know, kind of in this world where, you know, we have this unknown pause that's eating cash, and depending on our business models, some are, you know, increasing, others are staying the same, others maybe slightly declining. But for a lot of us, it's a pause for new deals, its expenses are continuing. And, you know, as a founder, it's scary. And, you know, we had to make some hard changes and do, you know, do a handful of layoffs, not because we didn't absolutely love the team members, we did. We just financially had no idea what things would look like and needed to figure that out. You know, if you get to some of the kind of the more painful decisions, you know, that companies are having to make, Jen, right now, I think one of the topics that's really worth discussing is if you are in a situation where you don't know if you have enough cash and you have to make changes, how do you make those changes more compassionately? Because I think that we're exploring options in this crisis that we probably haven't explored before. Like, I don't think most tech workers were familiar with the word furlough.
That's
until
true.
Now.
Yes.
I don't think anybody had any flexibility in health term benefits. It's like, nope, 2 weeks and you're done. You know,
right.
Where, oh, how do we think about extending healthcare? Like, what are the real hard things and hard options that you're seeing kind of founders discuss and go through now as the options that were on the table now that weren't on the table last kind of in the previous versions of this?
It's a great question. And you know, I agree with you that the word furlough is not something that I've heard companies discuss until now. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, a furlough is a leave of absence of sorts, where a company, they keep their job and in a lot of cases their health benefits or their benefits, including healthcare, but they do not come to work. They don't get paid. Companies can decide in those instances to pay an employee a stipend or up to 50% of their salary, I think it is. But it's a different construct than I think, especially tech, has thought about before, but certain companies are doing it. So in terms of options, I would say, you know, three things that I'm seeing: 1, layoffs; 2, furloughs; and 3, reduction in pay. So a look across comp bands broadly, and Madan, I'm sure you can speak to this, but, you know, companies are really thinking, or a combination of all three. So depending on the employees and the roles and you know, what kind of cost cutting or cost savings are looking to achieve. Companies are looking at those three options primarily in order to reduce the spend on headcount and think about, you know, potentially retaining some employees or at least providing healthcare. And to that point, alongside those three options in terms of the construct of employment agreements, they're also looking at healthcare. So where companies are doing reduction in force. I do see CEOs, we actually surveyed the portfolio yesterday, and there are different arrangements in terms of healthcare. There's a tremendous amount of consideration going into how many months to cover for COBRA and what have you for impacted employees.
Yeah, I can add, I think you've covered most of the options and levers or bullets left. The one more thing that many companies are trying to do is this concept of de-layering, which is if you look at your normal organization, you have a manager, usual span is about 6 to 10 people. And now in a virtual world like we live in, well, the concept of span completely takes a very different meaning. So as you kind of think about layoffs, I think what the expectation from the exec teams and from the boards, et cetera, is how are you thinking about it? Is it just that you're going to take your most expensive people and say, and I'm going to reduce my burn? Or are you going to be thoughtful about the other levers that you have? One of the levers is, for example, can you de-layer and therefore get a people manager now to kind of handle 20 people? It's a lot of, a lot more load on the person, but then you start to kind of think about the org structures differently. Then the other piece, is just in terms of healthcare, everything that you could do from simple things. If you're letting someone go, make the person's last day on payroll the first of the next month, because in the U.S. you're going to get healthcare throughout the month as far as you're an employee on the first of the month. So, for example, you're laying someone off on the 22nd of March or 24th of March. You could say, I'm going to put you on garden leave till the first of the month because there's going to be some severance, I'm sure, associated with that. But then the moment you are an employee on the first of the next month, then you have healthcare covered for the rest of the month. So these are small things that you could do that you could still kind of, get to the outcome that you want. But those are the additional levers that that companies are employing. And I think the concept of taking a management pay cut is becoming very popular. Multiple companies have started to do that. And then even thinking about what does pay cut mean in terms of like, is this just a permanent pay cut, or are you going to replace that with options? Employees might say the options might not mean anything right now, but providing them some relief, saying, okay, look, we're thinking of a 25% pay cut. It's a big number, but a 10% pay cut, it's actually not a big number, meaning that for most people will not feel the pinch because you're not going out, you're not spending, your burn has come down individually and personally, and therefore a 10% pay cut across the company versus a 25% pay cut for, let's say, a certain group of people is a decision you need to make. And so these are the kind of trade-off that we're looking at.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And just to add to that, I think it's fair to say that all of these options are on the table and there's no, it's a one fits one. So every company is kind of using every tool at their disposal to put it together and come up with the right solution for them.
Yeah, and I'd say what I learned, what I've learned in this, and I've been through various versions of this in my life. And, when I was younger and stupider, I tried to do it all myself. And, I was hung up in a room with lawyers and I was probably scared and insecure around how we did it. And, I didn't involve anybody else because some book probably told me somewhere to not involve anywhere else. What I did this time, I think that was a bit different was, involve the rest of the leadership team. And, what I found with and even the people in some cases who are going to be affected with options, like we have option A, you stay part-time, and option B, you go. Like, we tried to engage with options where the best we could. And I was so surprised, I think in a positive way, just how the rest of the team just really understood the things that were going on. And, it wasn't like, I wasn't alone in a room doing it. And, everyone on the team was kind of like, yeah, for sure. I'll take, hey, what are we going to do? Let's get through this. And obviously I think that's harder in a big company. But in a small and mid-sized company, you really have a lot of different options. I think it'd be great. We've got, lots of questions pouring in. For those of you who are not on the chat, at the bottom of your screen, there's a Q&A button that you're able to click on type in, any questions that we'll go through. Our first one comes from Ali, I'm not sure whether Jen or Matt, and you want to answer this, but in terms of a furlough, the question was, can employees access government unemployment benefits?
I can take a stab at it. So generally speaking, it depends on each state law, but generally speaking, in a furloughed employee, you can take unemployment benefits. But for example, if you receive back pay after the situation is kind of, you know, gets better, then you will have to pay back any unemployment benefit that you've gotten. So that's just the overall framework on accessing, you know, unemployment benefits when you're on a furlough, but it depends on each state and it depends, and there are lots of exceptions. But you know, generally you can do that. So you can at least get some level of unemployment benefits right away. I'm not sure, Jen, if you have a different.
It varies a bit by state. And I think Canada is the same in terms of being able to do that. Hi, Anna. Anna Leary has asked, Jen, what are you seeing across the portfolio in terms of how people with kids, you know, are being kind of managed and supported through this process?
So to the topic of today's webinar, seeing very just tremendous compassion from CEOs, founders, and leaders at all levels for their teams to help parents, because parents have now become part-time teachers as well in many, many cases. So it's, you know, I think there's been a tremendous outpouring of compassion, and I'm getting great visuals from some of the portfolio companies with kids on the Zoom calls, you know, at all time. But I think here, the communication from the leadership is so critically important, and just letting employees know that it's okay. If somebody runs behind your screen while you're on a Zoom call, or you need to step out for a minute from a meeting, or hours need to be adjusted for certain reasons. Seeing a lot of intentional communication from the CEOs and the founders around that, and the heads of people, just letting employees know that that's okay. Great example of compassion. A lot of companies are publishing resources for parents. So there are huge lists of Khan Academy Kids, and there are all kinds of also free software out there that's helping with distance learning for children in K-12. I have three children. They're all on Zoom all day. Thank you, Eric from Zoom, for making that free and available to the education sector. But I think there's a tremendous amount of resource out there for parents, compassion from leaders, and also like an incorporation. There's with this in this new remote world, there's a level of intimacy where you're literally seeing into your employees' lives in a whole new way. So I see that, like, even at GGV, we have a Slack channel for photos and updates from employees' children. So incorporated in different ways. And we have a portfolio company that sent out a box of toys to all parents, or, you know, age appropriate things. So people are getting creative. They're doing it on all different ways. But I would say in general, huge moment of compassion and embracing the reality and just empathy for parents.
Yeah. The other thing I've seen a lot of is increased flexibility. Like, I found our organization had working hours have dramatically evolved as well, where, you know, for me, I'll wake up in the morning, I'll do the kids till 9:30. You know, my wife will come and do them until mid-afternoon. I'll take them for a couple hours and I'll do recess camp time and finish whatever they didn't get done in the morning. Then we'll switch back, and then I'll make dinner. And then after the kids go to bed, you know, we'll still have meetings or have a leadership drink or whatever, like, after that time. But because we're all locked in our houses, the dimensions around when is working hours and when you're not, I think, are much more flexible in a lot of ways than they were before.
Mike, this is Josh from the C100. Did we want to continue on to further Q&A, or was there anything you wanted to cover before we transition?
There's a lot of questions that are, you know, coming into Q&A, so maybe to keep it focused on the audience, you know, we can keep on that. So we answered that already. So just a question from Jeff, and Jen, you're probably the best. If you're a startup currently in discussions with a VC, do you still reach out with an update in the current climate? He said, hold off. My answer is, or do you hide? for a while, and then, you know, and then resurface.
So this I can answer certainly from the perspective of GGV, and that is absolutely reach out. We're in active discussion with companies every day. Our general partners are, I think they've talked to, you know, I can't even tell you how many phone calls they've done with the current portfolio. So tremendous amount of time with the current portfolio, but also with prospective companies. They really are spending time actively in the market, talking to those companies right now, because, you know, prospective companies are going through much of what existing funded companies are going through. And I think it's wise just to stay in constant communication with the VCs. My two cents would be to certainly send updates, stay in communication with them, and let them know what's going on. I think it's certainly, from GGV's perspective, very much appreciated.
I think this is also a time that you can build trust, you know, more than ever before. You know, what I see across my investments is the founders who come out and say, it's terrible, this is what we're doing, you know, and have an emoji of like, I generally have a much higher trust for that than the ones who I know it's terrible and are hiding or not, you know, not responding. So this isn't a great time to necessarily ask for money unless you're really in an emergency situation and they're an existing investor, potentially. But I think this is a really good time, you know, to build trust. And also, as an operator or leader, you know, the team is watching how you handle it. You know, the investors are watching how you handle it.
They are.
And, you know, everyone's watching, you know, kind of how you handle it. And there's a big, a big opportunity there. One of the other questions that I've seen come up on the screen, and then Madame, maybe you can take this, but I think everybody would be good to answer it, is how long should a company be planning for? Like, what, you know, what have you planned for, Madame? Yeah. Jen, what are you guys advising? Because I think it's really a question of time, because if you think about this being done by Easter and we're all jammed into churches in Easter, versus if you think about, you know, what we've seen come out of China, which is ahead of us, obviously there's different measures, you plan differently. How are you thinking about how one should be planning for the timelines that are attached to this? Madan, do you want to start?
Yeah, so I think, so we've started off with saying is, you know, making sure that we've got enough legs to run for 6 months, definitely. I mean, that is the first kind of gating. We've said could take 2 months or 3 months, but if you were to work backwards and say, if this were to take 6 months of zero revenue, you start with that as the as your constraint on your, you know, in your decisioning, and say, if you have no revenue for 6 months, what does it do to your cash? What does it do to your burn rate? And what does it do to, you know, do you have a chance, or what we call it, do you have a shot at goal? At the end of 6 months, because if you don't have a shot at goal, that means it really doesn't, then you're looking at very dire situation. But that's our planning approach. Do we have a shot at goal at the end of 6 months? And if this were to last beyond 12 or 12 months, what does that mean? So that's the first two plans that we would, you know, we put in place, saying, you know, what do we need to do to make sure we have enough shots at goal? Were this to last for 6 months, or were this to last for 12 months? So that's our first approach. And then I think we talked about it before, you know, every single opportunity to reduce cost, not just the ones that are visible, which are the furloughs and the salary reductions, et cetera, but can you go back, you know, for example, you're spending, let's say, $1 million a month on AWS. You know, can you go back and renegotiate terms with AWS? You may not. And the AWS is just, you know, a placeholder for all the vendors that you're working with. Where can you kind of get more cash? Or where can you save more cash and kind of get fun changed strategically? That's the two or three things that I am seeing across a bunch of companies that I sit on the board as well, saying, let's be really smart about, do we have a 6 months no revenue phase, and then, you know, a 12 month, you know, recovery phase.
I would echo that. And just to say, like, working kind of quarter to quarter, like getting through Q2, assuming a huge, you know, 80 to 100% hit in Q2. And what does that look like in terms of short term, and then 6 months, 12 months after that, to Madan's point. We have the privilege of being able to work closely with China. We have a lot of our portfolio was actually in China. So we've been able to talk to a lot of the founders there and to the deal team that works with those, that portfolio of companies. So it's a bit like looking forward 8 to 10 weeks. And some of the insights that they've shared is what's come from this in an 8 week sprint, they're able to really kind of figure out how to navigate through this particular period of economic turmoil. And there's been tremendous innovation. So I would say just if you're able, there's also a sentiment around innovating your model, to Madan's point, some of your vendors and your relationships there, your supply chain, like what are the opportunities for innovation as you're doing this planning as well? I think that's an important point.
Yeah, and I can share my own personal, kind of perspective. I think we were kind of coming into a break even, with cash in the bank, probably not going to be break even in Q2. We kind of took it in stages. So stage one was, how low do we think we can get costs to maximize the likelihood of buying as much runway as possible? And that involves really looking at everything imaginable. So, renegotiating with your landlords, saying, hey, next 6 months, we got to cut down 25%. I'm sorry. It involves renegotiating with any contracts, vendors. Some of the bigger companies are maybe a little bit harder. Like, I'd love to renegotiate our LinkedIn licenses if anybody has any tips for doing that. I was joking, I was going to sell them on Craigslist, but I don't know how that would go. Personnel contracts, like kind of everything being on the table. The second thing is then, figuring out your strategic plan for realigning the investments, to your point, Jen, in the areas that really make sense. So if you had a product roadmap that was like this, but only this stuff is really critical and sales are going to slow down in this period anyway, how do you maximize your investment across this and maybe park this and don't invest in this till later, because you want to have as much resources focused on commercialization often, as possible coming out the other side. And how we think about it, how I think about it from a timing perspective for us is Q2 and Q3 is definitely going to be rough, because even if we come out of containment at the end of Q2, Q3 is going to take a bit of time to turn back on. So we budgeted across Q2 and Q3 as it basically a combined half year, and all of our targets, all of our incentives are around that half year period. We're hopeful that Q4 starts to show some signs of improvement, but I think, whether it's pessimistically, but I think, or optimistically for a lot of companies, it will be into Q1 next year before, we really see, I think, the full range of that recovery come back. And again, we don't know how long it takes to recover from this pause, which is very different than, a recession that hits one part of the world or something, some debt market collapses. Like, this is so many industries shutting down in so many places that we don't know how long it kind of takes.
Michael, it's Josh from the C100. There's been a question that's popped up a couple times, and it's pertaining startups that are currently in discussions with VCs. The questions come up: do you still reach out to those VCs and investors and ask for updates, or in this current climate, is it better to hold off on communications?
Jen, Madan?
I would say definitely reach out. Updates are appreciated. Michael made a great point earlier about this is a time, you lead through good times and through hard times as a founder and a CEO, and VCs always want to know that you can do both. It's a time to step up, and we're certainly in active discussions with many, many, many founders, both current portfolio and prospective right now.
Don?
Yeah, I echo that. I think talking to both your existing board and other VCs on how you're kind of handling the situation shows the depth of your leadership, and that's always something that VCs look for. So I would very strongly encourage you to do that. And also, if you are the CEO or an exec, what is your capital allocation strategy? I think most VCs look for saying, does the CEO and her team understand how to allocate capital? And there is no better you know, for lack of a better term, a situation like this that truly bring, you know, highlights whether you understand how to allocate capital or not. And that's like a hallmark of a great CEO. It doesn't matter if you are a publicly traded company or you're a Series A company. And so I would encourage people to absolutely reach out to both their existing board, newer VCs, because people do want to take meetings. That for sure is happening because I think people's travel time has been cut. Their socializing time has been cut. So the work day actually looks like 16 hours, even though you might be kind of spending just 10 hours. It feels that you have so much time that you can kind of accommodate all of this.
Yeah, the only thing that I would add to that is I've seen good reach out and I've seen bad reach out in the last few weeks. You know, good reach out is kind of people being respectful of what's happening in the world and the situation and saying, hey, I'm sure things are nuts. You know, I'm understanding what's going on. Love to chat at some point. You know, I've found bad reach out is people just pretending that they're on level 10 aggression and nothing's going on and, you know, sending cold outreaches to talk about, you know, whatever. I think I've like, even if we look at it from a talent perspective, I found that our response rates have increased in this time period. But we've had to really update our messaging because everyone's in a very different situation. Some people are homeschooling, even investors and venture capitalists are dealing with the same issues as everybody else. So just being sensitive to your, you know, to your audience is definitely, and compassionate to your audience is definitely an important, I think, set aside as well.
It's probably worth mentioning the next session we're doing next week, which we'll close off on with more details, is about access to capital. So we'd encourage anyone that has further questions on that to join that session as well. We're going to throw it over to a question from Sean Landudok, who's the CEO of Code in Canada and the Global Talent Accelerator. His question is that now that companies all over the world are working remotely, the acceptance level of global remote talent will improve and companies may rehire with cost considerations before location. So he'd like the group here to speculate on the recovery and its impact on talent markets locally and globally.
Okay, go ahead.
I was going to say, from where I sit, I think that we were headed this way anyways. I think that this has been certainly a catalyst to that, and it will, the end state, I am optimistic that this will end up a whole, it will open up talent markets as people, as this becomes more possible and more the norm, and companies are able to execute and get things done this way with a remote workforce. But I would say over 80, 85% of our portfolio currently has a distributed workforce in some capacity. So most companies and startups are building teams this way, and I think this will only serve to accelerate that and certainly make new talent markets and talent available.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think it's not just on the talent piece that is like going to go remote, but also many of your products and services are headed that direction. For example, we're in healthcare. We're at the intersection of the pharmacy, the provider, the hospital systems, the doctor, the patient. And so if you look at how not only our talent situation is changing, but our product now, the expectation from our customers or patients is they want to be, to a large extent, digital, everything from telemedicine to door delivery of your medication, to going to the doctor only when you absolutely have to, is the new expectation that just happened in 3 weeks. We were lucky that we were trying to do that for the last 2 years. But if you take your business, there's so many aspects of your business that has changed that kind of tells you, that kind of, you know, gives a lot of hope. And on the talent piece, I think what I see is some level of wage compression over time. That's a great question by here, because what's going to happen with remote work and remote talent that we're getting used to is you would end up paying for a specific skill. So the management overload that or overhead that comes with that, which causes some overload, is kind of not going to be valued that much. So if I can find, for example, a phenomenal designer sitting in Boise, Idaho, charging me $45 an hour, versus paying someone on the ground in the office $85,000. It's a night and day difference in terms of absolute the skill. So, you know, it is going to explode in terms of remote work or the concept of being a you know, lone wolf contractor or lone wolf consultant. I think that's going to happen because it's given us, for example, the ways to make it work digitally. So far, most HR leaders, most companies were like, oh, I think this remote work doesn't work, or it does, and only for specific skills. And I want somebody to be coding while we're sleeping. So somewhere in Asia is going to work. But now with all of this working, I do see as the recovery happens, that, you know, people like say who during this time have had one or two wins under their belts for consulting for companies remotely are going to be very, very valuable. So that's another both positive and also not so positive in terms of overall wage compression for an individual, but for very talented people, they're going to be, you know, in great demand. And that means that org models that you thought, which was based on the more traditional way of managing, is going to be, it's already, you know, completely upside down, and it's going to be upside down as the recovery happens, because, you know, your boards and your exec teams are going to demand saying, why are we paying this level of compensation? Is it being justified? You know, and therefore the management overhead, I think, is going to go away to a certain extent, not go away completely, but there would be a 10-20% reduction in that going forward.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I would add to that is I've seen a lot of the startups, to your point, have already adopted these principles. You know, we have a lot of big enterprise customers, and I think where it's had a pretty dramatic impact has been on them as well, because, you know, they would have spent $50 million in their sales conference. They're now doing it virtually. You know, their senior leader was maybe a holdout, you know, wasn't getting video, now doesn't have a choice. So I think that if the startup community was already in this adoption curve here, I think they're going to go a little bit farther. Where I see it having a massive impact is with some of the, you know, the monstrous kind of more well-established enterprise organizations that are used to big infrastructure, where, you know, the CEO has now been forced to not have an office, that might say, great, let's cut our office space in half. Let's slash our sales conference to just being digital. We don't need to be there in person every year. Let's be more open to hiring people in Idaho or in Saskatchewan or in Alberta, where our salaries are going to be less, because before they were like, no, everybody must be on site. Now they've lived this. I think that they won't be able, you know, to go back to how the world was before. And that, I think it's going to really change. I think it's going to change a lot of things, from rents to other areas where things are going to be, you know, going to be rethought in the future.
I agree with that. And just to underscore the point, this has really been a forcing function, and to get everybody comfortable with the tools. As an example, Zoom was never readily or not easily available in China, and our whole China team is now on Zoom. So tools, you know, all over the world, and people are getting very used to using them, and it's going to change the dynamic.
Great, thanks. Just for folks, we have a lot of questions on grants, dilution, and equity. I think these are topics that we're going to cover in next week's session. So we'd encourage you to just bring those there. And I think our panelists there are best positioned to answer those. I'm going to focus on a question from Mark Sochin, who's a C100 charter member alongside Jennifer. He's the managing director of CEO Quest. His question is how to best handle layoffs in an environment when you can't speak to people individually. Layoffs have to potentially be done over Zoom. How do you practice empathy, compassion, that was previously advocated by Jen's comment? Any best practices there? And he followed up with what services can be offered to laid off employees, or outsourcing services that help with landing a job, and any other recommendations?
It's an excellent question, and one that we're fielding quite a bit right now, because layoffs are happening, unfortunately, over Zoom. We recommend, you know, kind of the same, and Madan certainly chime in, but the same principle where you have usually the hiring manager or the person who is the manager that's going to conduct the layoff with somebody from HR on the Zoom call. And just, there are a few things I think to pay attention to. as always, as you would in any other kind of scenario where you're doing this, taking this kind of action, quickly, like one, not making it about you or telling them they're going to, you know, everything's going to be okay. I think there's some basic parameters around doing a layoff that are important protocol to follow. Don't make jokes. This is, you know, serious as everybody knows, but it's easy to do sometimes in an uncomfortable situation. Don't blame others, or blame the virus. It's, this is just a circumstance that you have to deal with as a leader and a CEO or a manager. You know, just letting them know clearly, why, what they're going to get, what you're going to do for them, and how to ask any follow-up questions. So give them certain services. For example, with the GGV portfolio, we are compiling a list of impacted employees, and we have certain companies that are hiring. So your investors, I think, could be a good potential source of helping your impacted employees find soft landings across these companies. We have certain companies in the e-commerce sector that are, you know, posting record gains right now. We have a telemedicine company that's doing plush care that's doing incredibly well. So we have in certain enterprise SaaS companies who are looking for throngs of engineers, and again, don't care where they sit. So I think investors can be a good source. There are a few different career lists. Mike, just to nod what you has done an amazing job of putting some resources together for impacted employees and for companies that are hiring. So there are resources out there that you can make available. But I think clear communication, standard kind of following usual protocols, even over Zoom, and also letting companies, employees know very clearly what you're going to do for them and how it's going to work, with the specifics related to severance, healthcare benefits, all laid out.
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you, Jen. I think you've covered a lot on what best practices are. A couple of things that I can add to that is one is also one that's a best practice on how you deal with the employee being let go. I think lots of great ideas here. And also you want to be thinking about the team that stays back. So most people forget about that, because why is that important? One is people don't know who's being let go. And so what we found in a bunch of conversations are people surprised that it so-and-so has been let go, there's been no communication, or there's just a communication saying, oh, we just let go a bunch of people, and leaders are not stepping up to say, hey, we let go about 25 people, here are the names of folks we said goodbye to, sad to see them go, et cetera. But if you do not communicate that, then the team that is staying back is going to be in confusion, or that's number one. I think Jen made an excellent point here on publishing the list, of course, with permission from the employee, saying, hey, you know, employee Joe, can I add you onto a list? I'm sending over to my VCs or sending this over to an industry group, et cetera. Are you okay if I add your name and your email ID to that? I think that's going to be very, very helpful in terms of just making sure that talent is available. And then three, advise on how people can be an independent, consultant, contractor, or like pointing them to resources like Upwork, Go Catalina, and a whole bunch of talent platforms where, hey, this is how you could be an independent kind of contractor the next couple of weeks, and some advice on that. And then I think there was a comment around saying, their unemployment services, et cetera. Yes, absolutely. I think companies are using companies like Rights Management or Challenger and Gray and Christmas to kind of handle that. But I think you could do, as a company, you could do much more than that by just following these best practices and also helping people, especially as hopefully as the recovery happens, you might not be able to overnight hire these people back, but your first allegiance should be to the people that you let go to see if they can come back as consultants and contractors, et cetera. So it starts to build some goodwill. And many companies don't do that. They just open a bunch of recs and start hiring all over again. Doing that helps. I also know of a company that gave a $2,500 education credit where they could log into Udemy and a bunch of other courses and help you know, employees retrain on specific skills where the credit was paid for by the companies. You would just use the login to make it happen. One more great thing that you can do, guys, which I think my previous employer, Compass, did. It's public, so I can share that with you. So what Compass did, I think, was just exceptional. They just asked all the laid off employees to hold on to their laptops. The laptops were there. They cleaned it up. I think that is such a simple gesture. It is phenomenal. Right now, if you're like, you know, if you can't even, if you have to ship your laptop back, you can't go buy one, or you're already under stress. I think that was phenomenally well handled, while a situation of layoffs has never occurred. But thinking about those small gestures really help, because those laptops are going to come back. There's nothing you're going to do. It's going to sit in your IT warehouse, not even going to be opened by a box, you know, out of the box. So you could kind of build some goodwill on this.
Yeah, the only other two things that I've, you know, seen is the, you know, the first time I ever did layoffs in my life, my first company, I did it terribly. And, you know, I think it's not just the clarity and communication there, but I think also trying to go as far as you can, especially when you're a young company, to try to help the people afterwards, because I think that's really, the people will really remember that. And I think that's what we're trying to do. Laptops, yeah, we've done that as well. The other logistical complication that's unusual in this circumstance is that everyone that's affected probably has stuff at the office. So, you know, it's not a situation, you know, you're going to see these people again, and it's good that you're going to see them again. So we were talking today about, okay, you know, when the office reopens, we're going to have people coming to get stuff in a month, 2 months. You know, what do we do to minimize that and make it, you know, make people feel good about coming in to get their stuff? And I think that's looking at the fact that, you know, your talent community that works for you today isn't just your employees, it's also your alumni. So, you know, the way that we improve that is that, you know, we prove to the people that we're letting go that we can do more to help them find something that's great and that's next. We don't have the benefit of being, you know, Walmart that's going to keep everybody on for 6 months. So, you know, we're going to really try to focus on that interim view, but also recognizing that everybody has stuff at the office, which is really unique and not on top of the Zoom. It's like, it's there and people are going to come get it, and it's cool, and we'll have to figure that stuff out.
That's great. I think we definitely have time for at least one more. We're going to try and end on time. There was an anonymous attendee. I invite this person to share their identity if they're interested, but is there any experience or data on how much of a pay cut people could reasonably take and not have their lives that impacted? It was mentioned on the call 10%, but I know other people think it might be a little bit higher. Is this more of a feeling versus actual data?
Okay, Madan. You're on mute, Madan.
Sorry, guys. I'll jump on this because I mentioned the 10% number. Probably Jen can help as well. We're trying to look for data in terms of what is the actual in a cost of living index that you would kind of go back to, but it's going to take some time to kind of even find a study like that. But then if you were to say, okay, let's be practical about it, and given the fact that you're just not going out, and if your discretionary spend of your salary with about 10 to 15% on restaurants, on your lattes, and on our lunches and everything else, and those are coming down, that's the first thing that you would do to say that we'll start with the 10%, because that just makes practical sense. That's the kind of number most or what you would end up spending if you were on a regular office cadence of going to the office, coming back, et cetera, which now is not happening. And then kind of work yourself either downward or upward, depending on one, your company situation. And also too, as you get more data on, you know, what is the haircut that you can take that you will not feel the pinch.
Great, and I think if it's okay with you guys, we'll try and just do one more question since we have a minute. A question from, and that question was from Eva Bortiso, founder and CEO of Future City. Question from Gary Ziegler: if senior management cuts their own salary short term but continued working on the company, is it possible for them to get unemployment benefits?
Shorter answer: depends where you live, depends on your jurisdiction, depends on your state, depends on your province. and depends if you're the owner or your employee is probably the short answer. What I also say is that if you cut employees to equity, you've got to look at minimum wage requirements in different markets as well. So you can't, so I'll give you a stock for 3 months. You could do that, but you're also opening yourself up to minimum wage requirements, but you really need to just Google kind of minimum working requirements on a market level for those specific answers. There isn't one answer across the Canada and the US for that.
One thing I would say just in general, and I'm sure everybody's doing this, but just as you go through this, just make sure that you are in contact and getting the advice of counsel, legal counsel, really, really important, given some of the nuances in law across from state to state, province to province, country to country, always important just to make sure through this that, and even reviewing your communication plans, important just to have eyes on that.
Yeah, I think that's a great call out. Thank you, Jen. And especially I'll kind of shine the spotlight on the new FMLA law that just got passed by the Congress and is now a law. On April 1st, it's a federal law in New York. It's already the law. It's pretty complicated even for an HR professional trying to figure out what's New York state versus federal. There are lots of use cases. Everyone who's actually been impacted by the disease directly, someone's gotten it as your employee, to someone who's not impacted directly but can't find health, childcare, so there are provisions made for them. So it is absolutely worth it to discuss with your employment counsel or your local HR leader to understand how do you deal with an employee who might ask, saying, "I need to be off for 2 weeks," and there are provisions in the law that you will end up paying that person.
Yeah, and I know we're looking for some more information to drop today about the new FMLA legislation as well, Madan. Thanks for bringing that up. So everyone, it is officially 10 o'clock Pacific time or 1 p.m. Eastern time. We did not have time to get to all of the awesome questions. Our moderator, Mike Scissons, has added his email address in the webinar chat list here in case you want to follow up and answer those questions. Thank you so much for the engagement today. Really, really do appreciate it. We've also got some resources to share with you. Mike actually also added his open source list. I think we can summarize these and send them to you. You'll be getting a survey from us. It would be really helpful to us if you could answer. I think we've just asked for 3 questions about this format. As you know, we've got a few of these planned over the next few weeks. So please do take 1 minute to answer those questions. Next week at the same time, same place, please do join us if you have any questions about access to capital. We have an awesome group of people. We're actually inviting the managing general partner of Bedrock Capital out of New York City, Canadian by the name of Jeff Lewis, joining us, as well as Janet Bannister, who's a Toronto-based managing partner of Real Ventures. So please do join us for that if that's a topic of interest to you, and I know it is for several of you. So thank you so, so much again to our panelists. I want to thank again Madan, Michael, and Jen for your time and for sharing so openly. Really do appreciate it. It goes a long way in the lives of our founders joining us. So thank you so much. And I hope to see you all again next week.
If anyone has any additional questions, feel free to email or LinkedIn, any of us. Yeah. And appreciate everyone taking the time and, good luck as the transition rages on.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.